worship this morning, just keep our mind in our hearts that we are anticipating or celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ soon. You ready? Please stand. Join me in worship.
Yeah.
Heavenly Father, I just give you praise this morning and just thank you for these brothers and sisters to be able to gather and celebrate the coming birth of Jesus Christ. And this morning, I just pray that you open our hearts and our mind and be willing and ready to be moved by you and by the message, and just let ourselves be engaged. In your name I pray. Amen. Please have a seat. Time for some announcements. All right, we got youth Christmas party coming up on Friday at 7:30. Oh, it's a chocolate fountain party. Oh, that makes me want to go too. Gingerbread house making contest and white elephant gift exchange. Very nice. All right, next. We have the weekly events, and our events are at Tuesdays and Sunday mornings now. So slight change to the Wednesday meeting, so just pay attention and get plugged in. We have Christmas Zoo Lights coming up. So Jenny talked about this last time, but this is free of charge for kids, and there's 12 slots. I don't know how many. There's one left, so get on it, guys. So Jenny's up front, so if you're interested, talk to her. There's a link to sign your kid up. This is from 6 to 8 on the 17th. We have Sunday, December 18th, we have the baptism service, and we have new member introduction. That'll be downstairs, and CEC open forum at 1 to review the CEC bylaws. All right, and we have Saturday the 24th at evening, we have the candlelight service. This is we do this every year, and so just, you know, mark your calendars. At 7:30, it will be held downstairs. And Sunday the 25th is our Sunday service for Christmas. Anything else? I think that's it. So now is time for our fellowship. So if you could stand, move to the foyer, and the kids, you are dismissed to Jenny. And we...
All right, everyone. Good morning. It's good to be with you. Why don't you find your seat, find your Bible, and open up to Malachi. Now, I know some of you are saying, where in the world is Malachi? I want you to turn to the first page of the New Testament and then turn back a page. Basically, we're on the last page of the Old Testament, Malachi chapter 4. Malachi chapter 4. I'll give you just a minute to find it, because I know we're not used to turning to the book of Malachi. So we're taking a break for a few weeks from our City on a Hill series. We'll come back to that in January, and we still have one of the three chapters of the Sermon on the Mount to finish. But for the next few weeks, we're going to explore the theme of Advent. And this is going to be a three-part sermon series. So if you feel like we didn't finish the story at the end of today's sermon, that's true. Come back next week. Part two, and then you come to our Christmas Eve service downstairs for the third and final installment of the Advent story. Malachi chapter 4. Have you found it? All right, I'm reading from the Christian Standard Bible. For look, the day is coming, burning like a furnace, when all the arrogant and everyone who commits wickedness will become stubble. The coming day will consume them, says the Lord of armies, not leaving them root or branches. But for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings. And you will go out and playfully jump like calves from the stall. You will trample the wicked, for they will be ashes under the soles of your feet. On the day I am preparing, says the Lord of armies. Remember the instruction of Moses, my servant, the statutes and ordinances I commanded him at Horeb for all Israel. Look, I am going to send you the prophet Elijah before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes. And he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children, and the hearts of children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and and strike the land with a curse. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we open ourselves up to you. We ask that you would meet us in this text as it unfolds you and your glory to us. We ask that our eyes would be open to the truth, that our ears would be open to the truth, that you would cleanse us, that you would transform us, that you would meet us while we wait. In your name we pray. Amen. For most of us, waiting is hard. There's not many of us who are good at waiting. You go to the doctor, you have those lab results, and you have to wait. You have that interview, you think it went well, now you're waiting on a callback. You send in all your college applications, and now you or your kids are anxiously waiting. And then, of course, there's waiting about maybe even larger things. The country of Iran right now is so many people are waiting for their freedom. People are being executed. As people yearn for a change. We've seen China over the last couple of weeks experience protests. As people have longed for a change that they hope is coming, but they're waiting. The people of Ukraine have been at war, defending their homeland for over 300 days. They're waiting for an end to an unjust war. In the short term, they're waiting for their power grid to come back on so they can have heat in their homes in the cold European winter. They're waiting and wondering if peace will show up by Christmas time. They're waiting. But waiting is hard work. And that's what the season of Advent is all about. Advent is not simply a 24-day countdown to Christmas. Sometimes we treat it that way, and that's not actually what Advent is. Advent is about waiting. It is about entering into the ancient story of Israel, where they sang or would have sung. The song was written later, but that song that we began our service with, O come, Emmanuel, the hope of Israel, this was the cry of every Israeli heart for generations. O come, Emmanuel. They waited. And then they died. And another generation waited. They faced a lot of trial and tribulation, the people of Israel did. A lot of oppressors like the Babylonians, the Persians, the Greeks. By the time of Jesus, it was the Romans. And they were waiting for their deliverer, waiting for deliverance. And so Advent is when we enter into the story of Israel to sort of reenact that story with a focus on waiting on the first advent of Christ, which has already happened, and waiting for the second advent of Christ, which is yet to come. One person said that Advent is the only season the church has ever known. What does he mean by that? Well, think about it. Ever since the day of Pentecost, when the church was born, the church has been waiting. What have we been waiting for? You can shout it out if you know the answer. What have we been waiting for? Jesus, the second coming. We have been waiting for the return of Christ. The book of Acts begins with the disciples staring up into heaven, and the angel says, he will come back just as he ascended. And then begins this new age, this new era, where the church goes about its business and waits. This is why one writer could say Advent is the only season the church has ever known. But as we wait, we do so painfully. As we've just talked about, people all over the world struggling to wait, and we struggle to wait. We struggle for the world to be made right. You turn on the news and you see all that is wrong in the world. You look at your heart and you see all that is wrong in you. And we wait. We wait for things to be made right. That was the struggle of the Israelites in the book of Malachi. Part of the problem, though, was their own fault. Part of it could have been external, but part of it was also internal. Sin in Israelite society. And so in Malachi chapters 3 and 4, there's this struggle with God, as it were. People are groaning. People are complaining. People are waiting. And in the second half of chapter 3, I want to read a few verses from that chapter because it sets up our passage in Malachi chapter 4. In verse 13 of chapter 3, it says, "Your words against me are harsh, says the Lord. Yet you ask, what have we spoken against you? You have said, it is useless to serve God. What have we gained by keeping his requirements and walking mournfully before the Lord of armies? So now we consider the arrogant to be fortunate. Not only do those who commit wickedness prosper, they even test God and escape. At the time, those who feared the Lord spoke to one another. The Lord took notice and listened. So a book of remembrance was written before him for those who feared the Lord and had high regard for his name. They will be mine, says the Lord of armies. My own possession on the day I am preparing, I will have compassion on them as a man has compassion on his son who serves him. So you will again see the difference between the righteous and the wicked, between the one who serves God and one who does not serve him." There is this book of remembrance from chapter 3 where God says, you look at society and it seems like the wicked are prospering. It seems like the ungodly are the execs of the Fortune 500 companies. They're the ones running the countries. The ungodly are the ones piling up wealth and living comfortably. And the godly are in prison. The godly are in the poorhouse. The godly are suffering. So God said, therefore, I'm making a book of remembrance. Because God sees everything, and God is going to make things right. And how he does that is the story of Malachi chapter 4, where this theme of waiting is captured in two basic ideas, waiting for the day and waiting for the prophet. So first, let's look at waiting for the day. In verse 1 of Malachi 4, it says, "For look, the day is coming, burning like a furnace, when all the arrogant and everyone who commits wickedness will become stubble. The coming day will consume them, says the Lord of armies, not leaving them root or branches. But as for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings, and you will go out and playfully jump like calves from the stall. You will trample the wicked, for they will be ashes under the soles of your feet on the day I am preparing, says the Lord of armies." Waiting for the day. The writer of Malachi said, look, the day is coming. Now, every Israelite would have known instinctively what he was talking about. There is this grand theme in the Old Testament prophets, this theme of the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord was a time of judgment. It was a time of vindication. It was a time when God would return and would finally defeat evil once and for all and establish his kingdom of peace and prosperity. This was the hope of Israel. This is what they would have sung about when they were singing, O come, Emmanuel. They were looking for the day. And Malachi says, look, that day, it is coming. And when it comes, it will burn like a furnace. And all these people that we think are prospering, all these ungodly people who are running the world and running our companies and oppressing God's people, the day is coming for them. And it will come like a furnace, and they who have committed wickedness will become stubble. They will be burned away. This coming day will consume them, says the Lord of armies, not leaving them root or branches. The phrase Lord of armies pops up a few times in this passage, and it is a reference to the fact that God is the commander of all the angelic armies, and also on a secondary level, the human armies of the world. So, in America, the president is the commander-in-chief. He's in charge, ultimately, of the armies and the navies and all the branches of the military. Different countries are set up differently, but there's always someone who is in charge of the military. This is a very military phrase, a very military-esque language here. The God of armies, older Bible versions will say the Lord of hosts. It's the same idea. And the first and most basic idea is that of angelic armies. God is the one who is the captain of the host. God is the one who commands these invisible angel armies who execute his will upon the earth. He is the one who dispatches angels that we hear about famously in these Christmas stories that will unfold over the next few weeks. Angels that appear to Zechariah to predict the birth of John the Baptist. An angel that appears to the Virgin Mary to tell her that she has conceived by the Holy Ghost. Angels that will appear to the shepherds to announce that the king has been born in Bethlehem. God is the Lord of armies, the captain of the hosts. And if he commands these grand angelic armies, then he also commands the armies of this world. Ultimately, God is the one who is in command of the United States Army, the Chinese Army, the Ukrainian Army, the Russian Army, and all the other armies too. God is in charge. He is the Lord of armies. But that presents a dilemma. If God is in charge, why does he not punish evil right now? There is an unjust war in Ukraine. Why doesn't God step in right now? Why doesn't he deal with evil immediately? This is what we want. This is what we long for. This is what Israel yearned for generations, for centuries, for at least a millennia and a half. The prophet Habakkuk put it this way. How long, O Lord? It's a haunting question. How long, O Lord, must evil prosper? How long, O Lord, must tragedy envelop our societies? How long, O Lord, until the day that we have all been waiting for? The day when the God of angel armies will sweep in at the head of his armies and execute vengeance upon his foes. How long? Ultimately, this is a longing for what the Old Testament calls shalom, peace, wholeness. When society is put together the way it is meant to be put together, when all of our relationships are ordered properly, personally, ecclesially, within the church, within our families, and within society. Every level of our relationships will function as they were meant to be. This is what happens on the day, and this is what we're waiting for. Now, these verses can sound a bit grim. They can sound harsh. But God's people in every generation have found comfort in verses like these. and verses like I want to show you in Psalm chapter 69. In Psalm 69, verses 19 through 28, here's what the psalmist said. You know the insults I endure, my shame and disgrace. You are aware of all my adversaries. Insults have broken my heart, and I am in despair. I waited for sympathy, but there was none. For comforters, but found no one. Instead, they gave me gall for my food, and for my thirst, they gave me vinegar to drink. Let their table set before them be a snare. Let it be a trap for their allies. Let their eyes grow too dim to see, and let their hips continually quake. Pour out your rage on them, and let your burning anger overtake them. Make their fortification desolate. May no one live in their tents, for they persecute the one you struck. And talk about the pain of those you wounded. Charge them with crime on top of crime. Do not let them share in your righteousness. Let them be erased from the book of life and not be recorded with the righteous. There are many examples of what's called imprecatory psalms, where the psalmist basically breathes out a prayer of vengeance upon God's enemies. Christians have often struggled to know what to do with these inspired texts. The Holy Spirit wrote these ancient songs. What do we do with songs like these? Well, we don't always know intellectually what to do with them, but when disaster strikes, when injustice rears its head, we know intellectually and emotionally exactly what we're supposed to do. When Russia invaded Ukraine, Christians everywhere were turning to the imprecatory Psalms. It felt right for this moment. God's people cry out to their deliverer, and they cry for justice. They cry for the day of the Lord to come and for evil to be smashed in the teeth. This is what God's people have ultimately been hoping for forever. But many people will scoff and say, no, he's not coming. Evil is just going to keep on going. There's nothing you can do about it. Just put your head down, take care of your own stuff, take care of your own family. There's nothing you can do about evil. God is not coming back. 2 Peter tells us that there are many scoffers who will deny the return of the Lord. And they will say, look, it's been, what, 2,000 years? Are you sure he's coming back? Look around you. Evil dominates the land. The darkness descends upon our society. The ungodly are the ones in charge, whether it's of countries or businesses or families. God forbid, sometimes even churches. And so they say, where is the promise of his coming? Peter tells us this is exactly how it was before the flood. People said, Noah, there's not going to be a flood. What are you building that great big boat for? You're wasting your time building this elaborate structure, and we're eating and drinking and we're being merry. We're living the good life, Noah. You sure you don't want to join us? And Noah and his family built the ark as evil people prospered. Peter says it's just like back then. Suddenly the judgment came. Suddenly the day of the Lord came. There was warning. Noah was a preacher of righteousness, and the ark was big enough to include many, many people. But nobody believed. And God sent the judgment. Peter said the second coming is just like that. There's ample opportunity to repent and to turn to God in faith. There's ample opportunity to board the ark of our salvation, who is Jesus Christ. But eventually time will run out. The day will come. burning like a furnace, when all the arrogant and everyone who commits wickedness will become stubble, and the coming day will consume them. But it's not just bad news. Verse 2 says, but for you who fear my name, those who are Christians, the Sun of Righteousness will rise with healing in its wings, and you will go out and playfully jump like calves from the stall. The sun will rise, and as the sun rises, its heat will first judge the wicked, but then its heat will also heal the righteous. The sun is a powerful metaphor. We know it can scorch us, and it can save us. If Earth were a little closer to the sun, life would not be possible on this planet. If Earth were a little farther from the sun, life would not be possible on this planet. God put us at just the right spot. There is power in the sun, and God harnesses this metaphor to help us envision the Sun of Righteousness rising with healing in its wings, and God's people experience everything that they have been longing for. Every generation that has followed God has built upon the legacy of the previous generation. We have built upon the legacy left to us by our spiritual ancestors. And like them, we wait. We wait for the day when the sun will rise with healing in its wings. But we're not just waiting for the day, we're also waiting for the prophet. This part's a little bit more mysterious, less clear. Verse 4 says, remember the instruction of Moses, my servant, the statutes and ordinances I commanded him at Horeb for all Israel. Look, I'm going to send you the prophet Elijah before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with a curse. The very first point that we need to make here is that it tells us to remember the instructions of Moses, God's servant. To remember the law means to obey the law. Waiting is not passive. God has just told his people to wait for the day of the Lord, but they're not sitting around doing nothing while they wait. What are they to do? They're to remember and obey the law of God, that which has been handed down to Moses, my servant. While we await the second advent of Christ, we don't wait passively. We wait actively, doing everything that Jesus commanded us to do while we wait and long and yearn for our coming King. We wait actively. We obey God's law. But then there's this prophet. Verse 5 says, look, I'm going to send you the prophet Elijah before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes. Now, if you're familiar at all with your Old Testament, and I don't want to assume that you are, you might have heard of the prophet Elijah. Not to be confused with Elisha. Elisha was his apprentice who took over for him after Elijah went to heaven. Notice I didn't say after Elijah died, because Elijah is one of two people in the Old Testament who did not die. I read the story this morning. Elijah was enveloped by fiery chariots, angelic messengers driving this supernatural chariot, and they took him up to heaven without him dying. Similar probably to what happened to Enoch in the book of Genesis. Now, if that story seems a little bit weird or bizarre or odd, I get it. That sort of thing doesn't happen every day. In fact, it only happened twice in the Bible. But Elijah has this unique relationship with God. And in the Jewish mind, there comes to be this association that Elijah is one of maybe the two most important people in the Old Testament. There is Moses, and then there is Elijah. Moses represents the law. Elijah represents the prophets. And so people would talk about the law and the prophets, and it was their way of talking about the entire Bible. It was a shorthand way of saying the Bible, but they would say the law and the prophets. And so then they could say Moses and Elijah, and what they're talking about is the whole Old Testament. Remember Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount? We've been talking about it. He said, I didn't come to abolish the law and the prophets. I didn't come to knock out the Old Testament and get rid of Moses and Elijah. No, instead I came to fulfill it. So Elijah, because of his incredible prophetic ministry where he did many miracles, where he helped Israel in many situations, and then where he was miraculously translated to heaven without dying. Because of all of that, Elijah loomed larger than life in the Jewish imagination. And God promised in verse 5 that before the day comes, this great and terrible day of the Lord that we've just been talking about, before the day comes, God will send Elijah, the prophet Elijah, to prepare the way. Jewish people, when they celebrate Passover, if they're doing it properly according to their traditions and customs, they have an empty chair and an empty table setting. There's an extra plate, an extra fork, an extra glass. And that's for Elijah. Because maybe this year is the Passover at which Elijah will show up. And there's a point in the Passover Seder in which you send a child to the door to see if Elijah has come. Now, what are they doing when they do that? They are ritually reenacting this idea that before the day comes, the prophet must first come. Elijah must first come. Now, funny story, our family celebrated a Passover Seder once with a Jewish woman. She was in her 80s. She was not a Christian, but she became really close to our family. Her name was Amy. And we were trying to share the gospel with her, and she would come to church with us sometimes, and we decided to observe a Passover Seder with her. So we had the empty spot for Elijah. And at the point in the Passover Seder where my dad was about to send either me or my sister to go to the door to check if Elijah had come, we heard movement in the other room. And we were like, wait, what's going on? Turns out we had left the flue open in our chimney, and a bird had flown down our chimney and was flying around in our living room. We were like, it's Elijah. It's crazy. But Jewish people take that very seriously because they believe, as Malachi 4 says, that before the day comes, the prophet will first come. Now, if you're making connections in your mind to the New Testament, that's great. I'll talk about that more next week. I'm not going to spell out all of those connections just yet. But this prophet, this Elijah figure who was to come, will come, and when he comes, he will heal relationships. Do you see that? Verse 6, he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with a curse. Probably, it's not just that God cares about familial relationships, although he cares about those. I think these are kind of a stand-in for saying all of relationships. When Elijah comes, when the prophet comes, he will begin the work of repair. Repairing the relationships that have been broken by the curse. This is something to look forward to. To look forward to this day. To look forward to this prophet. Now, as we kind of reenact the story of Israel as we enter into Advent, we do so as a people who are waiting. We are in between. Fleming Rutledge, in her book on Advent, said, "The life of the church is poised in the time between." All we've ever known is life between the first Advent and the second Advent. So we wait. We wait for those test results. We wait for those job interviews, those college acceptance letters. We wait for an end to war. We wait for freedom for our friends and family. We wait for God to change the heart of our spouse. We wait for God to send revival to this church. We wait for God to come back. And as we wait, we ask with the prophet Habakkuk, how long, O Lord? How long? Now, I don't know what edition or translation of the Bible you're using. It may not be set up exactly like mine is, but in my Bible, if you turn the page, then it's blank. Maybe some of your Bibles are set up like this, because there's a blank spot, and then the New Testament starts. The verses that we have just read are the very last verses of the Old Testament. There's a day coming, and there's a prophet coming. And then it's almost like you turn the page, and there's silence. 400 years of silence. Before you get to turn the page and read about a prophet who has come to make way for the day. You see, Israel lived in this blank page. They lived right here. We also live in that blank page. Now, we have some further information, which we'll continue to unspool over the next couple of weeks. But we have to wait, just like they did. And we ask with them, how long, O Lord? That's what Israel asked while it awaited the coming of its Messiah, something that we will celebrate at the end of this month. And that's what we do every day as we await the second coming of Israel's Messiah. We wait with hope in a dark time. Let's pray. Jesus, we await your return. There are many who doubt that you're coming back. Perhaps even some of us on our darker days have doubted that you're coming back. But we believe in the literal bodily return of our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that you would come and institute this day that we have read about. That you would banish evil, put an end to wickedness. That you would remove injustice from this land. That righteousness would flow. That peace would prevail. We know we cannot accomplish this on our own efforts. And so we pray, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen.
Please stand.
Receive your benediction. Now to him who is able to protect you from stumbling and to make you stand on that day in the presence of his glory without blemish and with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, power, and authority before all time, now and forever. Amen.
Be seated. And that concludes our worship this morning. Thank you for joining us. And you're dismissed after a silent moment.